Hi. So, welcome to the last session of today before the social event. So we will talk about three-channel evaluation and distinguishers. And our first speaker is Gaëtan Cassier from TU Graz. And he will speak about information bonds and convergence rates for three-channel security evaluation. Thank you.
Thanks for the introduction. So yeah, the topic of this paper and this talk is about the evaluation of the security against side-channel attacks. So
supposed to work.
Okay. So yeah, so as an introduction, if you look at the profile side-channel attacks, so typically most powerful side-channel attacks, I'll just recall it to get some notation. So we have some key chunk, like a key byte of the AES, we have some plain text going in, and then we have an intermediate variable Y. That's, for instance, a byte at the output of some S-box, for instance. And then we have the leakage that you measure, and then the adversary takes a model, for instance, a template that's predicting the distribution of Y given the leakage L. Once you have that for multiple traces, you aggregate them to get probabilities on the key, and then if your most likely key is the correct one, then you succeed, otherwise you fail. And based on that, you can compute some success rates. And here, the whole question that we have in this talk is, what's the number of traces that an adversary will need to get some given success rates? So it's the leakage certification problem. Difficulty is that if you want to make a plain evaluation of that direct, you need to do many attacks. So first of all, you have to be able to do attacks, to vary the number of traces, and then to compute that many times to average and compute the success rate. So that's quite expensive. So here the talk will be concerned about shortcuts to do that. So the first technique that we'll use to get a shortcut is the bounds from 2019 that says that we can have a lower bound on this number of attack traces as a function of the success rate, that's a function we don't care about today, divided by the mutual information between the leakage and this intermediate variable Y. Which reduces the question for the talk, how to get bounds on this mutual information. So that's the core thing we studied in this paper. So here are a few parameters for our problem. So we have our leakage Y, the intermediate variable Y. So typically this will be an n-bit value, for instance, 8-bit value output of an S-box. So we'll know that it's a uniform value. So not much question on its distribution. Then we have the leakage trace. Typically, it can be a continuous value, so in real numbers, or a discrete value because it's the output of an oscilloscope that has omega bit of resolution. And then you get D point of interest in the trace. So we assume that you know D dimensions. And then the adversary will build some model of the distribution of Y given some trace. And this approximates the true distribution P. And then, of course, to build this model, we have some set of traces that we have. So we have a set of attack traces, a set of profiling traces. So the profilings are the one that we use to build the model. So yeah, state of the art on this bound of mutual information. All of this comes down to the formula for the mutual information. We can write it that way. So the first time is easy to compute because we assume we know the distribution of Y. If Y is uniform n bit, this is just n. Then we have the expectation of the log of the probability of Y given L. So this is like the thing that the adversary uses the model. And then we take the average of that. I've put it in blue and red color because these are the places where distribution, the joint distribution of Y and L appear. And so that's the place where we have to estimate something and get bounds on this. So I will use this notation, which is basically the same formula, but I replace the true probability distribution in those two places with some models that we will estimate. And let's just note that this delta m prime, if you put the true distribution, you arrive to the mutual information. So first bound on this is the perceived information already more than 10 years old, and that was studied in a crypto paper 2019. And there the idea is you take at the lower place the p, so the true distribution, but on the upper place of the delta, you put the mutual information. So here, it means that you take the exact expectation, but there, instead of putting the real probability, you put a model. And this corresponds to typically what an adversary can do. You can profile the model, you can use these logs. And actually, there is a proof in this 2019 paper that this is a lower bound for the mutual information. And actually, this PI corresponds to the number of traits that the adversary that uses this model M prime requires to do the attack, typically larger than the optimal one, but hopefully a good model will be close to the actual one. So slight problem here, we cannot compute this PI because there is still this P probability distribution that we don't know. So what we do is we replace it with some estimation. So we'll take another set of traits, validation traces, and we do the average over that to approximate the actual expectation. So the way we write this is we say that we have this ESV. So SV is the validation traces, and this E tilde is the empirical distribution. So in discrete case, it would be building the histograms from the set of traces. And here we can see that, of course, if we take the expectation of this over the ESV, then this is a non-biased thing. So the expectation is still a lower bound for the mutual information. Now we have a lower bound. Let's look at an upper bound. The same paper provides the hypothetical information. So there we work in an ideal world where we assume that the actual true distribution of the traces would be exactly the same as our model. So that's what the hypothetical information computes. So instead of using PP for the MI, you use M prime for your model. And there the paper goes a step further. Let's assume that now the model is an empirical model, so this histogram thing. And then you can prove that in expectation, you have an upper bound for the mutual information. So up to here, it's all good and well. We have a lower bound, we have an upper bound, everybody is happy, and we have no paper yet. So here the problem comes. The bound should be tight because if we have a lower bound that says mutual information is between zero and the entropy, it's not really useful. So the key question that's tackled in this paper is how many traits in our profiling set, so NP, that will be fitted into this empirical distribution or into the model for the perceived information, how many traces do we need? And here, that's the first thing that we look at in the paper. Is we look at this gap between this empirical hypothetical information and the mutual information. So this thing should converge to zero to get a tight bound. And we see that this is log-log plot, so this is 1 over n, 1 over the number of profiling traits. So the convergence is fast, except that how many traits we need depends on this dimension, so number of points in the leakage trace. And here you can see that the bound grows exponentially with the d. So here we have a pretty short trace of only 4 points of our oscilloscope. And if you want something small, you're already in the millions or hundreds of millions of traces. So I'll let you imagine what it is for thousands of points in the trace. It's just never going to converge. And the root cause of it is what's the effect known as curse of dimensionality. So with high dimensionality probability distribution, it's hard to estimate. And we want tight estimation because having histogram down to zero doesn't work well when you have a logarithm somewhere. This is very specific to the empirical hypothetical information due to this empirical side. If you take the perceived information, you can take as a model something like Gaussian templates that are very easy to fit. And then the empirical average that you do doesn't need that many samples to converge. So for the PI, we don't see that problem. So first solution that's actually proposed in this Crypto 2019 paper is to use a non-empirical HI. So instead of using your empirical model, you use Gaussian templates. Here is a very simple example. We have a 2-bit masked variable and typical Hamming weight, noisy Hamming weight leakage. And we build Gaussian templates. So the top figure is the distribution. So the continuous line are the true distribution and the dashed line are the estimates. What's more interesting is the bottom plot we have here on the top. The Gaussian HI, so the HI with this Gaussian templates model, in red, the mutual information, and in blue, the PI. And so the x-axis is the number of profiling traces. So here we see that we have a nice convergence and we like that. So we have a tight upper bound, lower bound, we don't need that many traces, all is fine. And then we change the noise level. So here we have pretty low signal to noise ratio. If we increase the signal to noise ratio, on the top, we can see that this Gaussian mixture distribution starts to look like a Gaussian mixture and not almost Gaussian here. And then we're not so happy because we see that the HI is not an upper bound for the mutual information. It's actually not even an upper bound for the perceived information. So it's not very useless. And as a last case, if you even increase the signal to noise ratio with the last thing, with HI is between the PI and the MI. So basically anything can happen if you don't take the empirical HI. So lower bound is still okay. We have the PI. Upper bound empirical HI doesn't converge fast enough, non-empirical HI is not a bound. So we're looking for a bound, which is the second contribution of the paper. So here we introduce the new matrix. And the core observation that we have is that if you allow any kind of leakage, estimating the probability distribution is difficult. We are back to this HI style of thing. It converges slowly. There is no easy way to estimate it. So we'll introduce additional information. And here we'll collect, assume that the leakage, or more precisely, that the adversary makes the assumption that the leakage is in some class of models. So for instance, the collection edge of model could be all the Gaussian templates, all the neural networks that share some architecture, or a bunch of different architecture. This set can be pretty big, but we assume that the adversary uses some model. And then, of course, you have some parameters to tune, the parameters of your templates or the parameters of the neural network model. And we assume, we'll assume that the adversary takes the best one because, yeah, assume it's a good adversary. So this leads us to define the new metric, the learnable information, how much you can learn under this restriction of class of model edge. So what you take is you take the supremum of the perceived information of all the models in this class. And that's the definition of the LI. And this is always lower than the mutual information because the PI is always lower than the mutual information. And so in the next, we'll focus more on this LI because this is actually matches what number of trees and that would, an ideal adversary would have to select the best model would be able to do. So this is a relevant metric to bound. Of course, we'll have to do this assumption of edge. And if we have a better adversary that thinks outside of this box of edge and finds a better model, we don't have a bound anymore. But that's the price to pay. So we, here there is a, the first assumption. So this LI, learnable information, is lower bounded by the PI, as comes from the definition, and it's a lower bound for the mutual information. Now we'd like to have an upper bound because the original problem is upper bounds. So here we'll think about what the adversary can do if he wants to take an high PI, because higher PI means higher, larger models. So ideally you'd like to maximize this thing, find a model that maximizes this. Of course, the adversary doesn't know P. He only knows the profiling sets. So naturally, what you do is instead of taking the true distribution P, you take the profiling set at this place. And here, our notation means that you use this empirical distribution based on that because you just try to maximize your average. You replace the average on the distribution P by the average over all your practical traces that you get. So that's what's known as empirical risk minimization in the field of machine learning. That's also used in practice for machine learning. So then we define this hypothesis as being a TI maximizer. So an adversary is a TI maximizer if he selects the model that maximizes this metric. And then once we know an adversary that does this, we can define the TI as the training information. So how much the adversary can expect to see of information based on his training. So what he does is he does the training, selects the model here, and then he evaluates it on the profiling traces. So here we can see that there is a kind of overfitting going on for the metric because you select the model based on the profile, and then you evaluate it using the same set of traces. So it's a bit like the hypothetical information. We evaluate the model using kind of the same data that was used to train it. So we accept like, to see something higher than the PI. And actually, we can prove that the expectation of the TI is an upper bound for the learnable information. And this is an example that shows, so we have on the bottom part, the perceived information, the upper part, the training information. And then, of course, it depends on the speed of convergence depends on which model you use. So if you use an MLP that has many parameters, it's slower to converge than something like Gaussian templates. Which brings me to our study of the rate of convergence. So we have been able to prove that the perceived information and training information converge in probability to the learnable information at these rates. So these rates, this is just an informal notation. So what does it mean? This tiles hides logarithmic factor, we don't care. It's in one over the number of profiling trees. So we can actually see this curve. It's basically one over n. And then we have this poly of h, which basically means that we are polynomial in all the typical parameters of the model. So if you look at Gaussian templates, it would be polynomial in number of classes, polynomial in number of points. For machine learning, it will be polynomial in your number of weights, and so on and so on. So the big interest of having this convergence rate bounds is that you can stop the training at this stage. Imagine that you acquired only 10 to the 4 traces. If you know the slope of this, which is 1 over n, you can say, okay, I want a tight bound on my learnable information, I don't know, 10 to the minus 2 bits. And you can basically extrapolate this slope by knowing that it's the slope of minus 1, roughly. So that means that an evaluator can make a short acquisition time to know how much more you will need to acquire. Maybe 100 times more, maybe 1,000 times more to get the tight bound. But you can predict that and you can know if it will fit in the time that you have available for your measurement campaign. If not, maybe you will have to focus on a simpler model. If you have more time than needed, maybe you can try to use more powerful models. So this gives me to the conclusion that we can see. So for an evaluator, we have these all plots of like training information, perceived information over the number of profiling traces. And then basically you can say, okay, I see these traces and I have some security target level. This target should be very secure, should be secure against X traces for the adversary. Again, using the formula from the beginning, you can translate that into a level of mutual information or as a level of learnable information. So here we have the three possible cases. On the left, this level is below the PI, in the middle is between the PI and the TI, and on the right, it's above. And these three cases will lead to three different conclusions for an evaluator. Quick remark, we have this fast convergence, so that means that in practice, it will be possible to actually get this to converge. So in the first case, we have a guaranteed insecurity because we have this PI that's above the target level. For every PI, we have a model, and we know that this model, if you attack using that, you will need fewer traces than what's your targets. So we have guaranteed insecurity, which is even an example of how to attack. And the gap between the TI and the PI is how much you can interpret it as an upper bound in how much you can improve the attack. So maybe you can still improve a bit, but not so much. Next on the right, we are happy. We have a proof of security. We have some security margin. And the interpretation of this is maybe you can still improve the security margin by getting more traces to get the PI down. And then you can improve your security certificate to even higher security level. And then you have the kind of in the middle case. And that's something we call the tightness gap. So you're like, okay, my security level is somewhere around what I actually aim. So the actual security is close to the true one, up to some factor, maybe like plus or minus 40% of the traces. And this plus of minus 40% versus 20% versus 100% will be determined by how far apart these two curves are. So that determines like, you know that the actual security is close to your target, and how close it is depends on this tightness gap. And typically you want, that's not something you're really happy about because you know strong conclusion, you would like to be on this case or on that case. And if you want to move to this case, you should get more training traces. But at some point, I don't know if this tightness gap becomes 2%, you know that the security of this implementation is exactly that plus or minus 2%, which might be on this conclusion for an evaluation. So to conclude, in this paper, we provide this side-channel analysis evaluation to assess the profiling complexity. So when you want to know something about the security, how many traces will you need to be able to give the certificate, is it secure or not? And we do that in a way that does not require to actually run an attack. And we do that by replacing this hypothetical information that was too hard to converge, empirical hypothetical information was too high to get to converge, we replace this with the training information that's actually shown to converge to the learnable information, which is actually a characterization of how good an adversary can be. We get fast convergence. So that means that we go to high dimensionality. We solve big problem. You just need to find a good model, such as Gaussian templates, LDA, MLP, or whatever you'd like. And the big limitation of the work would be that we lose the connection to the mutual information. So we have a hypothesis about what's our hypothesis class edge. And if the actual leakage falls very far from this class, then maybe we don't have an upper bound. But that's a typical information assumption that you have to do anyway when you do evaluation based on attacks, because you're still trying some models. Thank you.
Thanks, Gaëtan. Do we have any question? Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. I have a question. How much your conclusions are depending on the nature of the class of models H? How much it relies on the nature of the of this class of models?
So you need always a model that gives you this prediction of y given n, and then basically it works as long as you satisfy this hypothesis on TI maximizers. So we rely on this assumption, and so.
And I have a mean to I have a mean to check that I am satisfying with.
Okay, so for instance, if you're doing deep learning with cross entropy objective, this exactly satisfies this definition. Of course, that only works if you're really trying to optimize your cost function. If you do some regularization, early stopping, it doesn't work that well. So that's for our general result. You may notice that Gaussian templates do not fit this framework. So we have a special section on this where we actually studied this. And for some cases of Gaussian templates, pooled Gaussian templates with two classes and so on, we've bounced on the convergence of PI. And for the TI, we don't have any proof. We just conjectures because on many examples, it works.
Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. I have a more pretty practical question. Sometimes when you want to compute the PI, say with sampling, you need a lot of traces, right? For a given model, so for a given number of profiling traces. Do you have a way to know roughly in advance how many traces you will need for sampling, or do you just go until it kind of stabilizes and just decide that way?
That's something that's not discussed in this paper. I don't have any formal bounds on that. What I will typically do in practice is to say that this evaluation trace, validation trace, it just does an average. So you can explore the central limit theorem to take your sample of traces. You can actually have this value for many cases, and you can compute its average, which is x average of the estimate of the PI. But you can also take the variance. To have the variance of this value, you divide it by n, and then you get the variance that you still have for your estimate of the PI. And then you can compute the standard deviation, and you get an idea about how accurate you are.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, hello, hi. So I got questions. First of all, is the simulation or experiment here that you've done, is it on a univariate, on a simple, on single time sample, or is it on a multivariate data?
We've done multiple experiments. Many are on simulated data, one or multidimensional, and we've also looked at some well-known data sets such as ASCAD and multiple others. I would refer you for the paper for the exact list of data set that we looked at.
Okay. The second question that I have is that, could you please give a more intuitive explanation of how TI is better than this HI as mentioned before?
So the key observation is that the TI exploits only some model that converge faster, such as Gaussian templates, MLP, all of these are known to be able to converge, while the empirical HI is this histogram model. Basically, if you imagine that you have only a single bit of resolution for your oscilloscope, and you have 100 dimensions, this means that you have 2 to the 100 cases for your histogram to cover. So with any reasonable number of traces, you will only cover a very small part of the actual distribution. So you have a pretty poor representation of it. While if you have a better model, it will be able to generalize further. So it's a kind of typical case of induction hypothesis versus how much training data you need to fit the model.
Any other questions? We still have time. If not, let's thank the speaker again. And now this will be Balázs Idvarelli that we talk about efficient regression-based linear discriminant analysis for side-channel security evaluations.
Thank you for the introduction. So first in this talk, I will talk about the motivation behind the paper, then go a bit about the history of leakage models and why they don't work in our case. And then I will propose solutions to this. So first, we wanted to attack ISAP, which is a leakage resilient scheme. And the problem with it that you can only attack it using single trace attacks. So when you have single trace attacks, the first step is to extract as much information as possible from the leakage in a single trace. And then you usually recombine the different variables efficiently using Stuska. So in that sense, the contributions in our paper were the following. So we targeted a software implementation of ISAP. So in a software implementation, you have long traces due to the serial nature of the CPU. And you have large states because we targeted 32-bit implementations. And we also provide an efficient method to evaluate the PI of our leakage models. And we improved the belief propagation algorithm inside the Stuska. So first, here is the equation of a Gaussian template. And let's go through it, why we can simply use it for 32-bit leakages. It's simply because we have this. So this is the mean of each class that you have to estimate. And if you have 2 to the 32 classes to estimate, it becomes really costly in terms of profiling complexity. So you need much profiling choices. So this is for the large states problem. And for the long traces problem, you have this covariance matrix here that is large because you have many samples and it's difficult to estimate and invert therefore. So to solve one of these problems, you can use Schindler et al.'s regression-based Gaussian templates, where basically you replace the explicit calculation of the means by a weighted sum of basis functions that can be linear, as we used in this case, or quadratic, or even more complex. So the advantage of this is that you only have to estimate the coefficients AI, which are in the number of 33 in our case, instead of 2 to the 32. To solve the other problem, so the long traces problem, you can apply an LDA-based projection to reduce the number of the dimensions in your Gaussian template so that the covariance matrix becomes easier to calculate and thus to estimate. So here we use the projection matrix that you calculate with LDA or PCA. LDA has the advantage of maximizing the SNR in the subspace. And yes, and what happens if you combine both of these? So you get the advantage of the long traces problem with the LDA. And when you calculate the means, you have a lower profiling complexity. However, when you to solve the equations for the LDA, as we'll see later, it still needs some improvement. And fragment templates in the world of 32-bit leakages have been used to to model, sorry, to with leakages in an easier way. They circumvent the large states problem by using simpler models with manageable state sizes. So for example, if you have the 32-bit leakages, you can use 4 models of 8 bits. So you can use whatever leakage model you want, and the authors use the RLDA models inside. So you have even simpler profiling complexity. The not good side of fragment templates is that as you have only 8 bits, you profile 8 bits in one model. You still have 24 bits of noise, of algorithmic noise inside your model. So it's suboptimal in that sense. So what's the problem with the baseline regression based LDA is that when you calculate the projection of the LDA matrix, you solve the equation that maximizes the ratio between the inter-class scatter SB and the intra-class scatter SW. And to calculate these matrices, you need to have a sum over all of your classes. So the profiling complexity is still exponential in the number of bits. So I will not go really in the details, but I will just give you a general idea of what we did. So you can develop and simplify the equations of those scatter matrices. And in fact, it is possible to reuse the matrices that you use for solving the linear regression problem. And you can transform the sum over X, or over all the classes, to the sum over the number of basis functions that you have. So sorry, 3 in the case of linear functions, and more if you have like quadratic basis functions. We also applied a second projection matrix to have a unit covariance in the final distribution. And we were combined those two matrices, so the matrix from the LDA and the matrix that normalizes the covariance in the so-called WF matrix. And thirdly, we applied the projection on the coefficients of our real linear regression, so that we have the matrix AF that contains all the coefficients in the subspace. So this is the final distribution that you can obtain. As you can see, there is no covariance at all, which helps in calculating the result of the distribution. So a quick note on the complexity on the of the before and after. As you can see, for the profiling complexity, we moved to something that was exponential in the number of bits to something linear. And for the attack complexity, if you want to get a distribution of all the variables, you still need to go through all the classes, estimate the distribution for all the classes. So it's still exponential in the number of bits. But however, if you do a single trace attack, you only need to do it this once. So it's bearable. So what about when you want to estimate the PI that you have in your leakage model? So So in the previous talk, the PI is a lower bound to the meteorite information that helps the evaluator gauge the number, the correctness of the leakage model. So here is the equation for the PI. And as you can see, it depends on the probability of X conditioned on the leakages. The problem with that is that for in order to obtain the probability of X, you need to apply Bayes rule, and the denominator of Bayes is the sum of the distributions of all the classes. As I said, if you do a single trace attack, you only need to do this once. However, when you estimate the PI, you have to sample this estimate using many leakage traces. So it becomes more complex. So what we propose here is to use a clustering on the regressed means so that we are able to approximate this denominator. And of course, if you approximate something, we will have errors and we will bound these errors. So I just give you here a graphical example of what we have. So here are all the black dots are an example of regressed means that we can cluster this way. And we can therefore apply the the calculation of the probability of X. And the difference that we have is that we no longer have the sum over X, we have only the sum over the clusters, and it became a weighted sum with an introduced error. And this error impacts the probabilities, and therefore it impacts the PI too. The advantage, of course, is that the number of clusters should be way smaller than the number of classes. So what about the induced errors? They happen because the regression, so the black dots, the regressed means can be anywhere inside the yellow circle. And we can bound them using triangular inequalities. And therefore we can bound the PI too. So now what can we do to reduce the uncertainty, so have tighter bounds on the PI? So first we observe that the clusters that are impacting the most the tightness on the bounds are the cluster that are the closest to the leakage point in red here. So it would be this cluster here. It is because their relative distance from the leakage is much closer to the size of the cluster than, for example, for a cluster that is here. So what we propose in this case is to pop the cluster and explicitly calculate its contents. And therefore, you don't have the error, an error factor for this cluster. And you must only do this for clusters that are close. So you can still reduce the computation by not popping this cluster. Another way to improve the tightness of the bound is simply getting smaller clusters. But of course, there's a trade-off here because you will have to compute way more clusters and the equation gets more complicated. So now we'll show you some experiments that we did to evaluate if we are able to use this error leakage model correctly. So here we propose to have the leakage of a single isolated XOR on 16-bit instructions. So what we did is take two random inputs for a XOR, isolated bit with NOPs, so that we don't have the memory leaks, and we only have the output of the, we only measure the output of the XOR. And so due to the fact that we took random inputs, we will only measure the leakage on the output of the XOR. So we show here the PI that you can observe for different amount of dimensions of the subspace. And we show here in green the curve for the RLDA model. We have in blue just under it the LDA model. And in black, we have the mutual information of a Hamming weight leakage, just as a reference. And under it, we have fragment templates. And on the lowest side, we have the linear regression model. So there are several observations that we can make here. First is that RLDA behaves in the best way possible and even outperforms the LDA. So the explanation behind that is that we used a too small amount of profiling traces for the LDA, and due to the reduced profiling complexity of the RLDA, we need less traces, and so we were able to get a better model. On the other hand, you have the linear regression models in orange. You see that the choice of the dimensions is really, really important. For example, the first five that we chose were not good at all, and it's only the sixth one that helped. So this shows that you really have to use LDA-based dimensionality reduction techniques to be able to gather many samples and get the best out of them. And about fragment templates, we can see that they perform less good than our models, and they even are lower than the RLDA, than the mutual information of the Hamming weight. So in this case, for 16 bits, we were able to compute explicitly the PI. So we calculated all the classes. But when we moved to 32 bits, we were not able to do that for practical reasons. So we show here the bounds. So we have the upper bound and the lower bound of the PI. And of course, we were not able to calculate the blue curve, which is the LDA curve. So we only have here in this plot the RLDA versus the fragment templates. And in this case, we can also see that even at 32 bits, the RLDA is performing way better than the mutual information of the Hamming weight and the fragment templates. What it's important to see also that the tightness of the bound is decreasing with the higher dimensions, is because with the higher dimensions you introduce error on those dimensions too, and so the size of the cluster becomes less and less enough for fitting the classes. And so the bound becomes less tight, and it's harder to cluster basically at higher dimensions. So this is for an evaluation. We stopped at dimensions at six dimensions, but however, when you perform an attack, you can easily go way beyond those dimensions and attack at 10 dimensions, for example, or 15 or 20 if you want. You simply just must imagine the curve here and hope for the best. So now we show that RLDA can be used for modeling 32-bit leakages. Now the question is, can we use it to attack 32-bit implementations with single trace? So basically, can we attack ISAP? So just before that, we touched a bit on the SESCA side, on the of the things too. When you use a SESCA, you have to pass informations to relations like the XOR and AND. And those relations are costly because the basic function, the base method to do so is in N squared, N being the number of classes. This is because you need to check for the two input variables, whether they correspond to the output or not. So you need to pass through all the possible combinations of two 32-bit variables, which makes N squared. When you have XOR relations, you can have a more optimal way of propagating through these relations is using the Walsh-Hadamard transform. So basically, you transform the inputs, you make the simple product between them, and you transform the inverse to get the output. And in the paper, we show a similar transform that enables similar n log n complexity for the propagation of n gates. So we have XOR and n gates in our factor graph. We are now ready to able to attack. So as I said in the introduction of the slides, we targeted the initialization of ISAP's rekeying. So here you can see that it only depends on the key and the fixed and public IV. So this is a perfect scenario for something that you can average your measurements to boost your signal, so to reduce your noise, not boost your signal. And therefore, this is what we did. We performed 100 times average measurements. And we mounted a single trace attack using the following factor graph, where we had seven profile variables in blue. The red ones are the relations. And we also have a public IV and a non-profile variable. So here are our results. For the attack, we use the two leakage models. You use the fragment templates and the RLDA model. And here we can see on the right the rank of the key in bits for before and after the SESCA. So the main conclusions here are that five out of six attacks that we performed were able to get the key rank below 2 to the 64. We also saw that fragment templates did not perform good enough to reach the 2 to the 64 rank. And we also can see that the SESCA has a pretty low impact in our case. So to end on a good note, we provided an artifact for for all our scripts and for our experiments and our dataset too, so you can reproduce those experiments at home. And RLDA, I did not dig into the implementation side because everything is public and implemented on in Scalib, which is an open source statistical analysis library. And this is a Python library with a Rust backend, so we focus on high performance and parallel implementations. And the contributions of into Scalib were the RLDA model, the PI estimation with the clustering, and the efficient propagation of the Saska end gates. And you can try it now. It's on PyPy. Thank you.
Thanks, Balazs. Do we have questions? Yes.
Thank you for the talk. In the last numbers that you got, the key ranking, what did you use to estimate those key ranking? On how many experiments was it estimated, and with which method?
It's the histogram-based key rank estimation. And we performed 6 attacks.
Okay, right. Okay, thanks.
Another question. I have a small one. So I understand you have a 100 average on your trace. This is not always possible, right? But then it will make, if you didn't do that, you will have to do 100 times more computation, right?
It's harder because the information you can extract the information you can extract from an non-average trace is much smaller, so performing a single trace attack on non-average trace would probably lead to something that would fail. So in our case, the averaging really helped, and it was this is much more possible to the attack of ISAP, I think, because if we would have needed to attack like a shuffled implementation where every execution you have a different shuffling, then the averaging does not help, and the PI that we extracted with non-average trace would not have been enough for a single trace attack. So the rank would have been higher.
No, but your attack can be extended to several trace. I mean, not single trace attack, right? I mean, yes. It's not limited to it.
But in the case of ISAP,
you have several trace, you can have several trace with different inputs, which can help also discriminate the key. So maybe if you can't average, you can still have a beneficial of having several different traces that will help somehow.
Yeah, in fact, I guess what you mean is that this leakage model can also work for differential power analysis.
Yeah, and it
and
help.
But in our case, the only inputs are the key and the IV, which are fixed, so we were stuck with simple analysis.
Yeah, that's right. Analysis. Okay, thank you. Another question? Yes. The front.
What are the actual sort of CPU time RAM requirements for the 32-bit Saska that you did?
So the timing complexity of the attack, I did not understand.
No, practical. What sort of machine do I need to do as 32-bit Saska?
Sure, that's a big important point. As one distribution of 2 to the 32-bit state, in float 64 is 32 gigabytes that you must store in RAM. With the Saskad, we needed to use a cluster with more than 1 terabyte of RAM. So this is a bit complicated, but what we also observed is that the distributions are really sparse. So there is a way probably to reduce the RAM usage here, so that maybe we can work on a smaller workstation.
So you would then just truncate the probability tables.
Yeah. So it's not exactly here, but it's close to that, around 90% of the values in the distributions can be truncated, are already zero. And another more than 5% can be truncated to zero without reducing the PI very much.
Okay, thank you. And runtime? What sort of runtimes did you have for one attack?
Yeah, so the CESCA part was not optimized when we had the paper, and it was bottlenecked by the Walsh-Adamar transforms, or the Luca, similar to the Walsh-Adamar transforms. And it was in the matter of hours for one attack.
Okay.
Yes.
Thanks for the talk. In the case of SPA, here you saw that you had much better result than fragmented template. So if you were in a DPA case when you have a varying input, do you think you'd also have a faster convergence rate than a fragmented template? Or and can you say something about that?
In the case of DPA, I would say it's more of a trade-off between the resource that you have and the number of traces that you want. If you want to have the smallest number of traces, then yeah, go for 32-bit leakages. But as with DPA, the algorithmic noise can average out with more traces. Then you can simply use 8-bit models or 16-bit models and take more traces.
Yeah, of course. I was wondering if what would be the gap for the convergence rate.
Yeah, did not analyze that.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Then let's thanks Balak again. And please welcome the next and last speaker of the session, so Matteo Dell'Amico from Genoa University, and he will be talking about MC rank, Monte Carlo key rank estimation for side channel security evaluations.
So thank you very much. I'm waiting for the slides to appear. I can start by saying that I'm presenting in the place of Giovanni Camorati, who's the first author and unfortunately couldn't come here. And I want to thank him for, in addition to everything else, for preparing the slides. Okay, which are now up. Okay, great. So yes, we are talking about key rank estimation. It's a classic problem. As we have seen in the previous presentation, it's actually something that has a role in evaluating the strength of attacks for side channels. So as typical, you have some key, which is a secret key. It is used to perform some kind of encryption. Data is propagated through a side channel. Well, the side channel attacks basically ends up ranking possible keys. And you get some, to stay generic, you get a score for each of the possible keys. And the attacker, when they want to try and find out whether the key is the right one, basically they just perform a sorted enumeration, starting with the highest score key, checking it out whether it works in the case they are trying to attack. If not, they go to the second, and then so on and so forth until they find the correct key. So basically here we say, okay, so the key rank is simply the number of failed attempts that the attacker needs to do in order to find the correct key. Okay, of course, if like in this example, the attempts are three, it's fine, the attacker can do that. But as in the previous example, in the previous talk, you need to make 2^60 or more attempts. Well, it's a lot of work, and there might even be cases in which the attacker might be motivated to do something like that. Think about, I don't know, some months of computation in order to break your key, but you don't want to do that while you're doing a security evaluation of your system. There's a similar problem actually for finding password strength. So how is the problem formulated? You have your password,
which is your secret in this case. You have a hash, which the attacker came to know somehow. And well, they have a password model. A password model is something that ranks password by how likely they are. So for example, this would be something that would rank a stupid password like 123456 very high and put a higher score than the other ones. So basically the attacker would pretty much do the same as we have seen before. They would try each one of the password by decreasing score and actually try to find out which is the correct password. And then the password strength. So this kind of meters that tells you whether your password is good or not, if they're well done, which unfortunately is not often the case, they take into account some kind of reasonable attack and they approximate how many attempts the attacker will do in order to guess your password. Okay, so we claim that they are similar problems. So side channel key rank estimation and password strength estimation. In particular, here we are talking about model with a different meaning with respect to what we are generally using in side channel analysis, in side channel attacks. So here we're talking about the probabilistic model where basically we're talking about the key probabilities or scores given a particular side channel leak. Okay. Space, of course, in both cases is too big for exhaustive search. In general, for passwords, it's even an infinite space. And the attacks are similar. Basically, you have an attacker trying all possible combination by decreasing score and then stopping when they found the right ones. So there's quite a lot of work performing key rank estimation. In particular, we think that the histogram convolution algorithm is a pretty good representative with respect to the state of the art for key rank estimation. The paper has some arguments with respect to that. All these bunch of algorithms, basically they have in common that they do approximation. They give you deterministic boundaries. So they tell you basically for sure your key is between this and that rank. And they, in general, assume they have a key assumption that each subkey, so you divide your key into subkeys, and each subkey has independent probabilities. Otherwise, these systems do not work. There's also a couple of works that mention a Monte Carlo approach, but these kind of Monte Carlo approaches, they do uniform sampling, and in general, they do not converge in a useful time, and they are practical only when combined with other algorithms. So with respect to the password strength problem, we refer here to the Monte Carlo strength checking algorithm, which is arguably the state of the art for at least a large class of attacks. And there's also another interesting piece of work that adapts the histogram convolution model towards password strength estimation. So in this case, we do the opposite trip. So we go from password strength to side channel analysis, and basically we apply a similar algorithm for key rank estimation. We have some extension with respect to the original algorithm, and we claim it is a system which is fast, scalable, and it has the interesting property of not having to assume that subkeys are independent, subkey probabilities are independent from each other. And this has practical implications. So just to give you an intuitive idea, the problem with uniform sampling is that if we want to find out how big is the key part of the key space which has higher score than our target key, well, we might as well just generate random keys, find out what their score is, and find out which proportion of them is actually higher score than our target key. So in theory, this works. The problem with this is convergence. Why? Because yes, when you have a large percentage of keys that we generate in our sample, which are higher score than our target key, yes, we can just estimate the rank as the proportion that we find out multiplied by the size of the key space. Unfortunately, when we don't generate any keys that are higher score in our sample, well, our approximation would be zero. It's kind of pointless because we basically can only say, yes, it's much smaller than the key space, but we don't know how much smaller it, how big it is still. So this is basically bringing the same discussion that we have done before with formulas. This is the last session of the day, so I think pictures are easier to look at, but of course, feel free to have a look at the paper if you want. Basically here, the conclusion is always the same. The sample size that is required becomes impractically high. So how do we solve it? Well, this is the algorithm taken straight from the password strength literature without any extension yet. Basically, the key idea here is that rather than doing uniform sampling, we do a non-uniform sampling. And these kinds of solves our problem. It solves our problems we will see later if actually the scores are well-calibrated probabilities. If they are not, we need to do one more step. But anyway, here, we define the sampling probability equal to the score. Of course, we need to make sure that the scores are normalized and not up to one. And then we create a sample according to this sampling probability. Now, basically the formula that we need is this one, which is equivalent to this other one. You read this as one divided by the size of the sample, multiplied by the sum of the inverses of the sampling probability of all the elements in the sample set that have a higher ranking than the key that we are, the correct key, the target key that we are considering, that we are looking for its ranking. So intuitively, this is something that basically changes with respect to the previous algorithm because we have this kind of factor here, one over the sampling probability. And an intuitive justification is that we compensate for using that, for doing non-uniform sampling. This is something that comes from pretty well known since a very long time statistics. And it's similar to basically stratified sampling strategies. So the fact that this is an unbiased estimator has been proven in the CCS 2015 paper. And if you want a simple visualization, here we played with the toy example where we could easily enumerate all the possible keys. So we created a fake situation, AES-16, with only 2 bytes of key, so that we could obviously easily find out by brute force what was the ranking of our key in a simulated scenario. And we actually computed the rank here. Basically here, this is the histogram of frequencies for each of the scores for the passwords. And basically we're interested in finding out what is the area of the, what is the blue area, which basically boils down to be the number that we are looking for. So here we set our probability by, of course, taking the scores and normalizing them so that they sum up to one. And then we generate a sample. And now you can see that the sampling probability becomes something which is moved to the right. Because we are more likely to sample high score keys. And the result is that basically we use the formula that we've seen before and use it on the parts of the sample that get from the right part. And in this particular case, with a sample size of 4,000, we were basically able to come up with an accurate estimation for the key rank. Something more that we have done in addition to the password strength parts is evaluating the uncertainty. So here we can just note that the estimate that we do, we can see it as the average of several estimates with sample size one. So basically it's the sum of independent estimates with finite variance. So statistics tells us that when the sample size goes up, we have normal distributed error. Once again, simple statistics, and we computed the standard error of measurement. And based on that, we take a measure, which is probably easier for us to reason about, the uncertainty in bits, which basically is the logarithm base 2 of the 2 bounds of the 99.8% confidence interval, 3 sigma. So basically, this uncertainty value takes the same role as tightness when we take deterministic algorithms. Okay, so the uncertainty that we have decreases quite quickly with respect to our sample size, O of 1 over the square root of the sample size. And here we are plotting our confidence. We also double checked that actually we did have Gaussian, that the Gaussian approximation was good by using the bootstrap method, which is another statistics method, which does not assume that our data is Gaussian. It takes more time, but basically we confirmed that our estimates were accurate. So there's a problem, as I have alluded before, if the scores that you have are not actually a well calibrated estimation of the probability that the key is actually the correct one given the leak, well, this kind of algorithm might not converge quickly. And it might not converge quickly pretty much for the same reasons that we've seen before for unbiased sampling, for uniform sampling. And the reason is actually that whenever we take our sample, rather than having roughly half or a reasonable amount of keys that have lower score than our target key, and another reasonable amount of samples that have a higher score than our target key, we get all or most of them lower score, or the other side, all or most of them higher score. And this actually makes us a lot less certain about this. So we have seen that in practice, any percentage between 595% and 95.5% actually is good for having a good convergence. And in order to get something like that, we came up with this solution of rescaling. So the idea here is quite simple. We take the score and we elevate it to the power of a parameter delta, which is a positive parameter between zero and infinity. And basically it allows us to change the probability to change the probability of sampling, making them more uniform or more skewed. So when it goes towards zero, it gets more and more uniform. When it goes towards infinity, it gets more and more skewed. Basically, this actually guarantees that we will be able to end up with a balanced sample where the ratio between weaker, lower score keys and higher score keys is well balanced. And we just use a grid search on a smaller sample size just to sample what is the right rescaling parameter. And we increase it or decrease it depending on the ratio that we find between lower score and higher score. And basically the result is something like this. So for example, let's say here in this case, we have a sampling strategy where most of the things that we get from the sample are higher score than our target key. We take a sigma lower than one and we move the sampling probability to the left. So in this case, we have something which is pretty nice and divides into pretty evenly the two sides, the two parts. Another important thing that we have is that we can work with non-independent probabilities. So one important case is AES-256. And in particular here, we have the fact that, when we have a key, the left half of the key, the first half of the key, basically has a leak that only depends on the left part of the key itself, and of course the plain text. Whereas the right part of the key has something that also depends on the left part of the key. So basically, we have a problem because if we want to consider a key that has rank, I don't know, millions, billions, millions of billions, we should actually perform computations to do our, for example, template attack over a very large number of possible left halves of the key, which wouldn't scale. Fortunately, with our Monte Carlo algorithm, we don't care. And the reason for that is that we just generate a sample, and this sample generally is rather small, or at least attractively small. We see that in general, numbers that range between 1 and 10, 50,000 are good enough to get pretty good estimates in terms of precision. So basically, we can just perform our template attacks in our use cases only for the left part of the keys that we generated in our sample. So that makes everything a lot more scalable. So this is it with respect to the description of the algorithm. I'd like to point out we have an artifact that is available. Everything is open source. You're welcome to play with it. You can reproduce the results from our own paper, hopefully. And you can also reuse our implementation. It's quite easy to implement. In the end, it boils down to, I don't know, 20, 25 lines of code probably. So it wouldn't be hard to re-implement, but it's there. So with respect to the evaluation, we compare ourselves, as I was telling you before, mainly to the histogram enumeration, to the histogram convolution approach. We start with an evaluation over simulated traces using template attacks. And here we are faster when we get similar precision. Then we look at cases where actually we need the rescaling, because for example, when we have profile correlation, our scores are not actually well-calibrated probabilities. And once again, we perform better. We perform better in terms of, I think, a couple of orders of magnitude. So in this case, the histogram enumeration algorithm takes some tenths of a second, and we manage to get results in milliseconds. We also considered real use cases from the ASCAD V2 dataset, deep learning attack. Once again, we perform better than the state of the art. Then we consider some cases that were previously unsolved. So in particular, AES256 with the problem of having non-independent subkeys probabilities. And here, this is something that we were the first to solve. Our solution is fast. We go up from milliseconds to seconds, but still, I guess it's still acceptable. We also consider very large keys, and we compare ourselves with an extension over the histogram convolution algorithm. And in this case, we are the first to get to keys that are as large as 2048 bytes. Well, if we have a look at the paper, basically the kind of results that we have, we check and compare our algorithm, MCRank, with the state-of-the-art algorithms. We compare ourselves at similar uncertainty, so similar precision, and we find out that we managed to get a faster result. And we also compare ourselves with the algorithms with the same running time, and we manage to get lower uncertainty. So this algorithm, of course, has some limitation. In particular, we are using a quite simple approach for our rescaling part, which uses some metaparameters, which we found out decent values for making it run, but it would be nice to have a cleaner view of this, and maybe using something which is more refined and nicer with respect to grid search and with a more sophisticated analysis of rescaling. Quite interesting, there's been at Oakland this year a paper about confident Monte Carlo, which establishes better bounds for the approximation. So there are feasible improvements even there. And another thing that I'm quite curious about is if there are any other use cases with respect to this particular type of approach, basically key rank, password strength, but what else? We found that basically we have pretty much the same problem, and it solves the same algorithm solves two problems that might seem unrelated at first. So if two, then not why three or 1,000? So if you have ideas, I would be eager to hear them or read your papers. Thank you. With this, I'm finished, and I'm waiting for your questions.
Thanks, Matteo. Do we have questions? Yes.
Thank you a lot for the presentation. I was wondering, this rescaling technique, could it be applied to histogram-based estimation? And do you think it would be useful there?
The rescaling technique, can it be you? I don't know. Maybe we can talk about it offline.
Sure, thanks.
Thanks.
Another question? Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for the talk. The question, maybe it is stupid, but there are other contexts where you have a key dependency. For instance, the round keys of the AES are key dependent. Do you think that it could be a good context to apply your technique just to attack the round keys independently and to use the dependency to?
Okay. Unfortunately, I don't know. I'm not a cryptographer, actually. I come from the password strength research. So maybe this is a question I should turn to you. For sure, I would say that it could be possible to think that if not present, future algorithms might actually have the problem of not having this kind of independency assumption.
Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. Kind of same question for the non-independent case. So you get a rank for the non-independent case, but you don't have the associated enumeration strategy, right? Or maybe I missed something.
Yeah, okay. So obviously finding the correct enumeration strategy is also a challenging problem. One might think, okay, the attacker might do something that easy. Between the perfect enumeration and something, but that approximates the perfect enumeration. In our case, I think what is sensible to do in our case is to do a conservative estimate and assume that the attacker will do a perfect enumeration, and then the attacker might actually only do something worse than that. Then, of course, I agree that finding out the perfect enumeration might not actually be trivial.
No, I guess not. Thank you.
Yes, I have a last question. So so you use this non-uniform sampling to improve the number of samples you need. Do you have any hope to improve this? Or, well, you say this is a well-known statistical result. So this is the best we can do?
With respect to the sampling strategy?
Yeah.
This is a good question. Of course, when you see something like this, I mean, we just did something very simple and we found out that it worked, but there might actually be optimal strategies that, for example, do something smarter with respect to rescaling. It could be a good place to look at. Yes, admittedly, I think that this rescaling part might become even better with some more research.
All right, thank you. So if there is no other question, let's thank Matteo again.
Thank you very much.
And this concludes the session. So next is a social event at 4:30 at the in front of this building. We're leaving for the city tour.